Coming to the third part of our topic, work culture. A workplace culture is basically the shared values, belief systems, attitudes, and the set of assumptions that people in a workplace share. This is shaped by individual upbringing, social and cultural context. An organization is formed with certain goals, certain objectives. Each and every organization has certain goals which it seeks to fulfill or adhere to. It has the objective of bringing individuals together on a common platform and also to motivate them so that they can deliver their best. It is extremely essential for the employees to enjoy the workplace, for them to develop a sense of loyalty towards their workplace. Basically, in this third part of the topic, that is work, work ethics and work culture, I am coming now to the segment of work culture. Work culture plays an important role in extracting the best out of an employee and making them stick to the organization for a longer duration. Basically, so that the employees, they can enjoy working in the same place for a long period of time. The organization must offer a positive ambience to the employees for them to concentrate on their work rather than interfering in each other's work. So, what is this work culture? Work culture is a concept which deals with the study of beliefs, thought process, attitudes of the employees. That is one thing. That is, work culture is a concept which deals in the study of beliefs, thought processes, attitudes of the employees. Also, the ideologies and principles of the organization. It is the work culture which decides the way employees interact with each other and how an organization functions. That is, work culture of an organization is the primary decision maker which defines the way an employee interacts with another employee and how an organization practically should function. That is determined by the work culture. In a very common layman's term, work culture basically refers to the mentality of the employees which further decides the ambience of the organization. An organization is said to have a strong work culture when the employees follow the organization's rules and regulations, and also they try to adhere to the existing guidelines. Like if an individual follows the guidelines or the rules and regulations that an organization has demarcated for that particular individual, for an employee or for the employees, then if the employees, they follow that particular guideline, that is said to be like a strong work culture. A healthy work culture leads to what? A satisfied employee, and also it helps to increase the productivity. It helps the employees to be very cordial with each other. Also, each employee should be treated as one, that is, all should be treated equally and not partially. Appreciating the top performers is important, of course. That is, those who are performing better than the other, they should be appreciated. Also, discussions should be encouraged at workplace, because often discussing issues among the individuals, among themselves, it allows to reach better conclusions. Organization must also have an employee friendly policy, and practical guidelines should be there. There should not be anything like a fit-in approach for all, but it should depend on the current scenario. It should promote team building activities to bind the employees together. Now, the workplace is not just a place for accomplishing job-related tasks and earning a livelihood in the process. It is also some place which is consisting of repository of values, attitudes, norms, accepted procedures. Basically, every workplace has its own culture. Like a dominant culture, there can be one dominant culture along with multiplicity of subcultures. For individual workers, there are two sources of the workplace culture that shape the way they go about their work. Firstly, the kind of work they do, and secondly, the organizations in which they do it. Kind of work they do, that means, for example, like I'm a teacher, teaching is my work, that is the kind of work that I do. Or the organization in which they do it means the schools, colleges, universities, that is the organization where an individual works. Some occupations do not carry much in the way of culture, but others may foster subcultures that exert significant influences on the way people do their work and how they interact with one another. The same holds for the organization in which the work is done. That is to say, some organizations may have a dominant official culture, but individual components of these organizations also are likely to contain distinctive subcultures. These subcultures within an organization which is having a dominant culture sometimes promotes personal identification with the work organization, that is one role, one function, and at other time it creates an alternative, even oppositional source of identity. So the subcultures have variable effects. One is promoting personal identification with the work organization, and two, secondly, it often creates an alternative, even an oppositional source of identity with the organization. The significance of workplace culture. Why do we need this work culture or workplace culture? We all know that culture is one of the bedrock concepts in the social sciences. Culture definition has been offered by many sociologists and social scientists. Sometimes they differ in what they emphasize. Sometimes they include some elements. Sometimes they do not include or exclude some other elements. But basically, in all the definitions of culture, we will find two broad elements of culture. One is the material culture and the other is the non-material culture. Material culture, as we all know, it refers to the physical objects, resources, spaces that people use to define their culture. This include home, neighborhood, cities, schools, factories, plants, offices, tools, means of production, goods, products, everything basically. All of these physical aspects of a culture are the material culture that help to define its members' behaviors and perceptions. On the other hand, we have the non-material culture, which refers to the non-physical ideas that people have about their culture, like the beliefs, values, rules, norms, morals, language, organizations, institutions. For society as a whole, material culture encompasses all the accoutrements of life. For a given occupation, material culture comprises the things that are worked with and worked on. For example, what does it mean? Like, for a teacher, what is the material culture? The classroom, board, computer, pen, register, calendar, diary, everything that the teacher uses or works with consists of their material culture. The kinds of equipment and materials used at work may powerfully influence workplace culture, but it has to be remembered that they do not operate independently of the non-material elements of the workplace culture. That is the beliefs, values, attitudes, norms, and accepted procedures. What does that mean? That means because non-material cultures, these elements are intimately connected to the uniquely human ability to create, transmit, understand, manipulate, and respond to the complex symbols. Non-material culture is intimately related to the material cultures and defines the workplace culture. So, as we are going through this topic, work culture, Here, we have come to the most important concept of sociology. It can be said that culture, material and non-material culture, they defines together the concept of workplace culture. In the workplace, these symbols, they range from highly detailed written procedures, which means rules, regulations that has been written down, to subtle gestures that may convey a lot of information to those who understand them. That means those who are a part of the organization or who belong to the organization, they can only understand some symbols which are particularly meant for those individuals who are working in that organization. Symbols encompass anything that can be used to convey the values, beliefs, and norms of a culture. Organizational culture is an important topic of discussion in recent years, as some influential writers have stressed how an organization's culture can contribute to its success or failure. These descriptions and analysis of the cultures of various firms have emphasized the importance of clearly articulated goals and collectively held values. That means organizational culture, it reflects the goals of the organization as well as the values which are held by the members of the organization, along with certain ceremonies or rituals that express these goals and values. It also includes those individuals who help exemplify these goals and values and modes of communication that convey them. All this together constitutes an organization's culture. So basically, organizational culture includes the goals of the organization or the purpose for which the organization has been constituted, the values which are held by the individual members of an organization or the collectively held values, along with the ceremonies or rituals and individuals who are exemplifying them, modes of communication and how they are conveyed. The organizational culture is a system of shared beliefs and attitudes that develop within an organization and guides the behavior of its members. The corporate culture consists of the normal values and unwritten rules of conduct of an organization, as well as the management styles, priorities, beliefs, interpersonal behavior that prevails. Together, they create a climate that influences how people will communicate, plan, and make decisions. Workplaces usually share in a society's overarching culture. So basically, all the things are that we are talking about here, organizational culture or workplace culture or work culture, they are a part of the overarching culture of the society. But organizations, they also have their own culture. As with society as a whole, organizations for which people work, that can be any kind of an organization, they have a formal structure of some kind, along with an official culture set by the management and several subcultures tied to particular occupations or segments of the organization. So here we are coming to another concept, that is culture and subculture. Subculture within the broader organizational culture. Official cultures are likely to be manifested in clearly articulated organizational values, specific rules, and sometimes even in their dress codes. Subcultures have their own values, rules, and sometimes even language. At times, the relation between culture and subculture, that is workplace culture and workplace subculture, the two may be complementary. They can complement each other. But again, it can also be a source and reflection of conflict between different parts or segments of an organization. So sometimes culture, subculture can lead to complementary relationship. Sometimes it can be a source of conflict within an organization. For example, like if the main culture of an organization is non-profit, healthcare organization may be to serve the people, but the subculture goal may be profit making. So that can be an area of conflict when these two organizational goals are not complementary to each other. Some cultural elements emerge spontaneously. That is, they emerge out of the different activities of the people who are engaged in the organization and over time become embedded in the organizational culture through informal means. Others are deliberately propagated. That can be something which is deliberately constituted by the organization for the fulfillment of certain goals. Organizational cultures become specially evident when two firms merge. Each has its own set of values and ways of doing things, which in many cases can be the source of considerable conflict. Like if two organizations, for some reason, they are being merged into one single organization, and if those two organizations, they have their own workplace culture, then that can be a source of conflict when they are merged. Socialization into a culture. Socialization, as we all know, is an important concept. Socialization is the process through which individuals become part of a human society through the assimilation of society's dominant culture and perhaps one or more significant subcultures. Through socialization, individuals acquire a working knowledge of their societies, values and norms. In addition, they gain a sense of where they fit in by learning about the roles they are expected to occupy and how to relate to others while occupying those roles. In short, basically, socialization is the process through which we become human. We try to internalize the values and norms of a society and try to become a part of the society. That process is called socialization. This socialization process essentially takes place within an organization as well. An unsocialized or a less socialized individual would be someone who is like an alien, who is not particularly being able to fit in a land where everything will be a source of bewilderment for that individual. The activities of its inhabitants would be incomprehensible and their language will be unintelligible. While nothing in life would be predictable for that individual if a person is not properly socialized. Fortunately, except for a few isolated cases, all humans usually they undergo a process of socialization, and that helps them to, you know, like adjust and survive in different environments and even in different societies and in different workplaces. Socialization is a crucial part of working life as well, because nobody chooses an occupation or takes a job knowing everything he or she needs to know about the work. Sometimes some people undergo a kind of what we say anticipatory socialization by being exposed to a particular line of work through their family's social networks. This is particularly common for people who make a career of occupations like police or in a military family where they are the exception. They have a kind of an anticipatory socialization about what kind of work life they are about to enter or what kind of work life they will be getting in the future. So that is something else. But a large number of workers, in fact, if we consider, we might consider it to be the majority of workers, have not consciously prepared for the work they do. They simply took a job after a brief search, or they fell into one because this social network has made it available to them. Many occupations, even the high level ones, might be like someone who is a college professor or journalist. They are staffed to a significant extent by people who just drifted them into those jobs. Settling is not a permanent situation, like I am settled into a particular job. Occupational careers are characterized by significant fluidity. That means our socialization also continues throughout our life or throughout our work life, as we can say. According to US Bureau of Labor Statistics, according to a data of 2005, more than 3% of employees left their jobs each month, most of them taking a job with another employer. The Bureau of Labor Statistics also determined that at the beginning of 2004, wage and salary workers had put in a median of only 4 years with their current employer. As might be expected, older workers sometimes stay in the same job for a longer period compared to those who are younger. So, we can see that socialization at workplace, it keeps on as an individual changes from one job to another. The significant amount of job hopping experienced by most workers means that work-related socialization will occur on numerous occasions. Many things learned in the past will be relevant to a present job, but there are likely to be a number of things that need to be unlearned too. That means you will have to let go of certain things because you are about to enter or learn something new. At the same time, socialization for an occupation or a specific job is not likely to be an unambiguous process because cultures and subcultures are not always models of consistency. That is, socialization for a particular occupation or job, they are not always consistent. They change as per time, situation, circumstances. Finally, although socialization is a fundamental process in our development as members of occupations, organizations, and society as a whole, but there will always be an element of conflict in the process. Socialization creates roles and identities that are not always accepted by the individual being socialized. Like, as we are being socialized into a particular roles, sometimes we do not accept the way we are being socialized or the roles and identities in which we have been socialized. And it is the thing that should have happened or should happen usually. Otherwise, it would be very much monotonous, rigorous, and there will not be any scope for innovation or change. Socialization is an ongoing process. Socialization at workplace is also an ongoing process. Socialization conclusively ends only when a person dies or he or she ceases to be a sentient, that is, they are not being able to perceive or feel things. Only then we can say that socialization ends. Some periods of socialization are more intense than others. Sometimes it will happen that our socialization is much more. We are getting more socialized into certain things compared to some other times. But the cumulative effects of day-to-day socialization can be just as important as brief periods of concentrated socialization. Although it is an ongoing process throughout our lifespan, socialization sometimes occurs in distinct phases. For instance, consider someone who is preparing for to become a doctor. What that person will do in the beginning, during the phase of preparation, for example, for entering into medical profession or becoming a medical student, a person, he or she will get himself or herself socialized into a student for becoming a student. He or she will prepare for the exams or try for giving exams to enter as medical students. So that will be one socialization phase. Once that person has become a medical student, initially they might have thought that they are going to enter into this profession because they have an orientation to help people. They also assume that in the course of their studies, they would learn what they need to know in order to be successful doctors. But it might be so that during the first and second year of their medical school, they found out that they had no contact with patients, and much of their coursework seemed to be highly academic and removed from actual practice of medicine. In response, the students may take a pragmatic or sometimes it can be said a cynical approach of their education, letting go of the idea that they would learn everything that is required to be or required for them to know, and concentrating on what they thought would appearing on the exams. By the third year, the students began to be involved with actual patients. By interviewing them, asking them about their medical histories, performing medical physical examinations, this will make their education less academic, and their socialization now will be something different from their previous socialization, where they were socialized to think that medical profession or being a medical student, it is all about being academic. So that is one phase of socialization that they will be undergoing. But then also, they will be seeing patients to be treated as cases rather than as individual men and women. Slowly, as they are like entering after like they're forwarding towards the end of the course, they will understand that after they devote an adequate amount of time, they will be socialized to meet the patients directly, talk to them, treat them, and also they will understand or learn, or they will get socialized in the process that they will have to be less emotionally detached from the patient. They will have to be emotionally detached from the patients. Aspiring doctors do not lose their initial desire, but with time they are being socialized in a way that can make them to, you know, help them to provide effective treatment to the patients. So basically, this is the thing, that socialization occurs in different phases. Now, socialization helps in creating an individual's identity. By the time an individual has finished the training to become something, to become a professional or enter into a profession, that person develops a definite distinctive role or an identity. In this, they were not unique. The work of a person or what a person does is often a key element of his or her individual identity. Most of our identities are evolved around the kind of work that we are engaged in. In the words of Irving Goffman, a self virtually awaits the individual entering a position. He will find a me ready, made for him. There is certainly a large element of truth to this. The occupations we hold and the jobs we do can substantially affect how we see ourselves and how we are perceived by others. To a significant extent, occupational roles carry certain expectations about individuals that are independent of their personal characteristics. That is, the kind of occupation that we are involved in spite of our personal characteristics, that occupation creates an identity. That occupation helps us to develop a kind of identity which is associated with that particular profession. For example, like becoming an army officer. Being an army officer, it creates an identity of that particular profession where a person is willing to serve the nation, serve the people. One important marker of an occupational identity is sometimes a distinctive uniform. Not all professions have this thing, that not all professions have this particular uniform. All of us have learned to take notice of different kinds of uniform which are there in different profession and special occupational roles they denote. Occupational identities also can be created and reinforced through distinctive vocabularies. Occupation-specific words and phrases serve an objective function by giving names to essential objects and processes. But their use also distinguishes a member of an occupation from the public at large, whose ignorance of the specialized vocabulary marks them as outsider, occupational insider and outsider. Occupational roles and statuses also may be conveyed by physical surroundings. in a building's interior, furnishings often serve a socializing function by providing unmistakable indicators of organizational positions. In the non-material realm, socialization into a particular occupational culture can be fostered by invoking the lives and deeds of people who have embodied the ideals of particular occupation or organization. Sometimes we remember those individuals who have been particularly, like we can say, the heroes or the main role models in a particular occupation. Although all workers undergo some degree of occupational socialization, its extent and intensity vary considerably from occupation to occupation and also from organization to organization. As a general rule, the more professional the occupation, the deeper and longer will be the process of socialization. Workers who are lower down on the occupational role scale or occupational scale have fewer opportunities for socialization through long-term training programs, but they have a different kind of a socialization, which is associated or linked with their particular job pattern or the nature of work they carry out. A degree of social isolation can also be the result of a value system that divides the social realm into us and them. Once again, this is a situation that dangerous working environment fosters, especially with those who are engaged in those professions which involve some kind of danger. Some occupations separate workers from other people temporarily. Other occupations do so specially. Although many occupations can be found just about everywhere, some are limited to specific locals or locations. Sometimes there's another concept in the socialization, occupational socialization or workplace culture is the concept of rites of passage. Socialization is a long-drawn process and sometimes ceremonies occur which are called the rites of passage. These are common in many cultures, like ceremonies which signify to become an adult, getting married, these transitions. Even in workplace or workplace socialization or work socialization or workplace culture, rites of passage have been analyzed as having three general phases: separation, transition, and incorporation. Organizations, they have certain subcultures. Complex organizations are assemblages of separate units such as departments and divisions. Members of these different units not only have different tasks and skills, but sometimes they are likely to have different vision of what is necessary for the success of the organization as a whole. Not all of these, you know, subcultures create conflict. Conflict may stem from difference in age, education, fundamental disagreements over goals, values, priorities. Although separate from official culture, subculture imparted through informal, colleague-based socialization may be congruent with the formal goals and procedures of an organization. Informal socialization may even be essential into effective operation of an organization because many jobs present workers with so many complexities and circumstances that no amount of formal socialization can prepare them. So in those cases, informal socialization, which can be gathered through employees, between interaction between employees, can help them to achieve those goals. Sometimes in organizations, there occurs subcultures which is not meshing with the official one. Subcultures transmitted through interaction with workmates with official organization, which may be even in opposition to the main culture. That can be called a counterculture. It is not necessary that a counterculture will be deviant, but their deviance need not, or might be deviant, but their deviance need not be criminal or destructive. Socialization into a particular occupation is likely to be most thoroughgoing when individuals see their work not just as a way to earn money, but as a career. Career is different from just a job. It is a part of an individual's identity. It is an individual's sacrifice, commitment. A key characteristic of career is that it proceeds with certain stages, each of which may contain socialization episodes and experiences. The presence of distinct career stages provide an organized framework for life and work. Career progression in many occupations and organizations require moving upward in a pyramidal structure that offers a diminishing number of positions at each successive career stage. Although it can be at the center of a person's life, but career it involves does not always obliterate other social roles. Career or work role can be meshed with other social life roles. Formal socialization procedures are likely to emphasize some occupation roles to the exclusion of others, but they do not put an end to individual role strains. Socialization ends only when life ends. There is another form of work organization, however, that governs the way some individuals go about their work. They are basically called the professionals. Professionals are those who have superior skills and ethical standards of its practitioners. Professionals, they are required to undergo a different set of socialization process. That we will then go to our next topic in the next class.